Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Patricia Duff. I'm very happy to welcome our many call-in audience members and our very special guest speakers to the Common Good. We have a really extremely fascinating guest today and one of our very favorite political analysts to operate as our moderator. So we're going to get right to the conversation. We've got a very unusual phenomenon in the 2020 presidential campaign this year. A hugely influential slice of the Republican Party, including longtime conservatives and moderates, have broken with reelecting the leader of their own party, the President of the United States, no less, Donald Trump. These political operatives are part of the broader Never Trump rebellion that began 4 years ago as a largely sidelined cadre of appalled Republicans, but which has transformed in recent weeks into a potentially disruptive force in this year's presidential race. Groups such as the Lincoln Project and Republican Voters Against Trump are using guerrilla tactics and clever ads, and they may already be making a big difference this year. We are thrilled to have one of the leaders of these efforts, Sarah Longwell, who has decades of experience as an active voice in Republican politics, originally as the Vice President of and Communications Director of Berman & Company, and later with her own successful communications firm, Longwell & Associates. More recently, Sarah served on the board of Log Cabin Republicans, but became a Never Trumper in 2016. She is now the Executive Director of Republican Voters Against Trump, as well as Republicans for the Rule of Law. She's also headed up Defending Democracy Together, which advocated for Trump's impeachment. And to help us out, we are really honored. I'm so happy to have you. Our very good friend, Republican strategist and political analyst, Susan Del Percio, to host and moderate this conversation. Susan is a New York-based Republican strategist and founder of Susan Del Percio Strategies, who has advised dozens of candidates in New York and elsewhere, including Rudy Giuliani, for whom she served as deputy commissioner, and also an advisor to Governor Andrew Cuomo. Of course, many of you will be familiar with her from her many appearances on MSNBC. We thank you both so much for being with the Common Good today. And now I pass the baton to Susan to lead our conversation. Thank you, Susan.
Thank you so much, Patricia. And Sarah, thank you. Thank you for all you do and fighting the good fight for principled Republicans. I get to say that because I'm the moderator. recently, there was a story on you by Susan Glazer. And one thing that stood out was she set up the scene as there's a bunch of Never Trumpers. And all they do is kind of get around and talk. And then you stand up and like, all right, let's stop talking. Let's do something. So you did. So tell us where you are in this process.
Susan makes it sound much more cinematic than it was. As I recall it, it was actually Bill Kristol was talking and I started interrupting him and being like, hey, you're famous. Like, why don't we do something besides just sitting in these rooms with a bunch of sad Republicans and figure out how to fight back? And I'll admit to some naivete, I guess, early on. I mean, I really thought that Republicans, the Republican Party writ large, the Susan Collinses, the Lisa Murkowskis, the Lindsey Grahams, that they were going to be real guardrails. And that, you know, it was going to be a tough 4 years. But, you know, I thought we maybe were going to find somebody to primary Donald Trump. And we tried. I mean, me and Bill Kristol, we talked to Larry Hogan's very open about the fact that he considered it. And we talked to him. But none of it came to fruition. And so as we were going into 2020, and one of the things I did all along or early on was say, everybody was asking what happened to the Republican Party? What is going on? And so my background in communications sort of led me to know there's an answer to this. Like, we can go find out. And so I started doing focus groups with what I called at the time reluctant Trump voters, people who had voted for Donald Trump but rated him as doing a somewhat bad or very bad job. And I just started talking to them to try to understand why they'd voted for Trump. And ultimately, what would persuade them to stop supporting Donald Trump? Which brings us to this moment where the thing that I found after doing 3 years of these focus groups is the thing that people found most persuasive was not these, you know, abstract foreign policy scandals. It's not, you know, the ads with sort of the scary music and things like that. It is real Republicans just like them, expressing the anxiety that they all talk about having around Donald Trump. You know, it's not just that they think he should get off Twitter. You know, they think he's erratic. They think that he's a problematic character. They think he has good qualities too, things that I probably wouldn't give him credit for having. But, you know, there are, just in talking to them, I just thought, okay, so these people, you know, the women, for example, they would say, yeah, I voted for him. And then I felt like I needed to take a shower, or I went home and cried. And I thought, okay, that is a person who can be persuaded to not vote for Donald Trump again in 2020. And so, so I thought about how the personal stories, when we would show them, how that really moved people. And I thought, how do you build a project that is just hundreds of Republican voters and people who voted for Trump in 2016 talking about why they won't do it again in 2020. And so we really built Republican Voters Against Trump with that research in mind. And it was hard at first. And I'm sorry if I'm just going on and on. You can feel free.
Oh, please, this is interesting.
But you know, it took us probably 3 or 4 months to get the first 100 because people sort of didn't know what we were doing with them. People were nervous about, you know, going on camera and expressing how they felt. But once we got the first 100 and we launched, now they are just pouring in. We have almost 500. We got like 30 today so far. They're just coming in droves. And it's because I feel like there's a lot of Republicans who haven't been doing what I've been doing the last, you know, 3.5 years, which is constantly talking about why this is wrong. And instead they've been sort of, you know, struggling with it in their own communities. And now they want to get it off their chest. And so we've collected what is getting close to 500 of these testimonial videos, and we're about to spend $15 million in the swing states just showing these real stories to those soft Trump supporters, like the people I've been talking to in the focus groups for the last few years, to see if we can't knock off, even if it's just 3%. You know, when Donald Trump won, everybody knows this now, it's conventional wisdom, but he won three states by 77,000 votes. That's fewer people than are packed into a big NFL game. You know, if we can pull 1%, 3%, and frankly, I think we can do better than that, then we can give Joe Biden a landslide victory. And I think that Joe Biden needs a landslide victory, because I think that's probably the only way that you get Republicans to sort of own the fact that this was a mistake. This whole thing was a mistake.
Now, I definitely want to get into the nuts and bolts of the campaign, but I want to just, for those people who are doing the testimonials, and maybe you, I know I've gotten this question asked a lot, I'm sure people have to you, is they say, all right, you're not happy with the Republican Party, why not become a Democrat?
Yeah, I mean, I would become an independent before I would become a Democrat. I mean, look, in some ways, I'm not particularly tribal about politics, right? I have a set of things that I believe, and a lot of them just aligned more closely with what traditional Republicans have believed. I believe in American leadership in the world. I believe that free markets are good and have lifted millions of people out of poverty. I think that personal responsibility is a virtue that we should cultivate in our society, whatever. You know, I think that we should not allow runaway debt and deficits. And it's just things
like
that.
You don't have to give up your party just to vote against Donald Trump.
Yeah, I mean, look, I was here first. This guy shows up spending his most of his life as a Democrat and suddenly saying, I'm here to hijack the Republican Party. And I can't believe that people just decided to roll over and say, what, we don't believe in free trade anymore? Like, it's been crazy. The experience has been really wild. It's like the invasion of the body snatchers. And so anyway, I mean, I still just believe the same things that I've always believed around policy. And so I'm not going to change that. That being said, I will take any day. Policy is not what's at stake here. And I think for people who say tax cuts and judges as some kind of a reason for Donald Trump, there aren't enough tax cuts and judges in the world to allow a person who is actively sort of subverting the foundations of democracy and the rule of law. And so those things take precedent. I believe in liberal democracy much more than I believe in, you know, marginal tax rates. I believe in both of them, but I believe one is much more important than the other. And so it's not that I'm going to go and become a Democrat. I'm going to fight for the things I believe in. And at this moment, that means fighting Donald Trump.
Okay, so let's get into those nuts and bolts about, especially those three states. When we look at Michigan and Wisconsin, we really see, based on the numbers, that was a turnout problem for Hillary Clinton, because she just so underperformed Barack Obama. Now, when we look at Wisconsin, sure, Donald Trump did do a little bit, I'm sorry, Michigan, Donald Trump did do better than Romney. He got about an extra 100,000 votes. But what's interesting is in Wisconsin, Donald Trump received 2,000 fewer votes than Romney. So it really was, looking at this, it really was the other, it was the Democrat candidate that kind of blew it there. But Pennsylvania is, and that's your stomping grounds, is a whole different category. Because Hillary Clinton basically came just shy of 20,000 votes of where Barack Obama was in 2012. So it really was Trump finding these voters, and whether we call them the forgotten voters. He looked for new voters, got people registered, but to the tune of 240,000 more votes than Mitt Romney. Now, that's huge, and that is the story. I think people mistake the difference between Michigan and Wisconsin versus Pennsylvania. And I think it's that Pennsylvania strategy that Trump is trying to duplicate, not just in Pennsylvania, but in other places. Do you think that can work?
So, yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. This is how Donald Trump sort of pulled that inside straight, right? Just pulled the rabbit out of a hat in 2016, which was he found voters that weren't really in the, didn't vote otherwise. And it's something that comes up in focus groups all the time that I just, it's such a blind spot for politicos, which is, I have people say all the time, I'm like, why'd you vote for Donald Trump? Well, he's a great businessman. I watched him on The Apprentice for 8 years and he was really decisive. And I'm always like, I never watched The Apprentice. Like it never occurred. I always forget that he lived in people's living rooms for 8 years as this carefully curated consummate businessman and, you know, fired Gilbert Gottfried or whatever. And so he was became this vision for people of what like a decisive businessman is. And those people who maybe weren't normally involved in politics, but were fans of his, came out of the woodwork and voted for him. Now, the reason that I'm skeptical that he can duplicate that strategy is that number one, okay, so we've seen that playbook. So Democrats, they're not leaving anything on the table in terms of turnout this time. They were way, way too, I can't think of the different words, so I'm just gonna say cocky, and overconfident is what I should have gone with. They were way too overconfident in 2016, thinking that Hillary Clinton had it in the bag. And so, you know, I constantly am thinking right now.
No trips to Wisconsin.
Yeah, no trips to Wisconsin. And like they were spending money in Arizona, which I would agree with spending money in Arizona right now. But like, I bet you they wish they'd spent that Arizona money in Michigan. You know, like that there were just things that were totally left on the table. And so number one, the Democrats know that playbook. They will not make that mistake again. And then two, I just think that there was a lot of people, you know, independents broke heavily for Donald Trump. All of the, now, and we can all take polling with a grain of salt, but the independents this time around, I think are gonna break against Donald Trump. And all the polling shows that to be true because Donald Trump has to run on a record now. He can't just run around saying, I'm gonna build a wall that Mexico's gonna pay for. And you know, a bunch of people are gonna get excited about that. We're in the middle of a pandemic that he's mismanaged. It has real personal consequences for people's lives. Their lives are not better than they were 4 years ago. We're all living in our basements. You know, working, well, not living in them, but, you know, working in them, you know, people just, the personal consequences to their lives now, if you ask the Reagan question, are you better off today than you were 4 years ago? The answer for most people is no. And so I just don't think that he's going to be able to generate this forgotten man enthusiasm this time around for people who are like, let's shake things up. I actually think people are much more likely to say, I would like somebody who knows what they're doing because things are really, really problematic right now.
Well, we saw a new kind of enthusiasm in 2018, especially in the suburbs. And I would think that suburban women, especially, are kind of your prime targets. And especially where we are today, because nothing took down Donald Trump yet. Charlottesville didn't do it. Mueller didn't do it. Impeachment didn't do it. But somehow I think suburban women looking at trying to figure out if they should send their children to school and listening to Donald Trump is a tough choice. And we saw some of it in 2018, but what are your thoughts on 2020?
Well, just on that 2018 point, which I think is a really good one. I actually completely agree. I think the story is women. There is, and it's not quite that because it's also, I think it's coupled with, if there is high African-American turnout, coupled with the total cratering and defection of women from the Republican Party. The Republican Party's totally abdicated on women. I can't think of a stupider mistake that they've made. Republicans don't have a governing coalition or a winning coalition if they can't compete in the suburbs. And the suburbs absolutely mean women. And one of the things that I think is such an interesting data point on 2018 is you look at somebody like Alyssa Slotkin, right? So she's in a place where Donald Trump won by 7 points in 2016. So then in 2018, she wins by 4 points, which means that she had to have picked up people who voted for Donald Trump. And now she's in a very vulnerable seat here in 2020. And I don't know whether she'll hold on to it or not, but I do think it shows just how many people, and I'll tell you, when you, I do all these focus groups, and when you take people who voted for Trump, you focus on women, and you say you're only looking at people who rate him as very bad, it is filled with these women who voted for him in 2016 because they couldn't vote for Hillary Clinton. And by 2018, they were so disgusted and so horrified by him, they couldn't wait to go vote for the Democrats in 2018. And so I saw that shift happen more or less in real time. And that gender gap has turned into a gender chasm as 2020 has approached. I mean, you look at his numbers with women, and not just college educated suburban women, but white working class women too. He's had an 11 point slide so far with non-college white women. And if he can't hold those women in those more rural areas, that's where depressing that enthusiasm or those numbers going down, that destroys his theory of, hey, we've got all these people, you know, who've never turned out before. And also, I would just, I mean, it's such a simple challenge to them. In the middle of a pandemic, an health crisis, economic crisis, and racial crisis, do you think that there's another 100,000 people that are like, I'm loving what I'm seeing, and I want to go out and vote for this guy again?
It seems I couldn't believe the first 100,000, so.
Yeah, that's true.
But now, when you look at that, so we know those suburban women especially are gettable, as we call in the business. But can they be turned away by a bad, what would be perceived as maybe a too liberal VP choice by Donald Trump? I mean, by Joe Biden?
So
that's scary.
Yeah, it's a really good question. Here's what I think. I think that there was a reason Donald Trump really wanted to run against Bernie Sanders. And it's because that was the only way he was going to hold on to the suburbs. And I actually think if he did run against Bernie Sanders, granted, I don't know in this particular environment how things would have changed, but the suburbs, he would have been able to hold on to a lot more suburban voters. I think that this is a tricky one for Joe Biden because normally I would say a vice presidential pick doesn't matter that much. But of course, with his advanced age, it actually means, I think, considerably more than normal. And then also, I think there's a lot of people right now who are looking for the vice presidential pick as a signal of which way the party's going to go. That the Democratic Party is having a similar struggle to the Republican Party. They've just been able to really hold off their more populist, sort of far left flank. And if Joe Biden, you know, picks somebody who is perceived to be extremely liberal, I think it gives the Republicans something to beat up on them about. I think that there is some room for attrition with some of those suburban voters. That being said, I still think when I'm talking to these people now in the focus groups, they're so out. I mean, if you watch some of the videos, the testimonials that come in, the things people say are, I voted for him in 16, but this time I would vote for a tomato can if the Democrats put it up. I'd vote for a tuna fish sandwich. There's a lot of inanimate objects people are tossing out that they would vote for. So I think there's at least some percentage that I don't think is insignificant that are, they are completely out. They will be happy to vote for Joe Biden and whoever he picks as vice president. But I don't think it's meaningless. I think it does have meaning who he chooses.
Right. Now to follow up on the VP choice and how he should be running his campaign. We saw some polling recently that, you know, he's within 5 points in Texas. Someone has him up. There's this talk that maybe he should just go to run the board. Now, you said earlier that you hope he wins overwhelming. I do too. I think that could be done, though, in the popular vote. I happen to think that his best strategy is to get to win, is to get to 270. Do you think that there's a danger of him following too much in the Hillary Clinton playbook, looking to expand for a 300-plus victory versus 270, which could, if he goes for that bigger number, he could really start hurting those 3% that were 2% of the people that we talked about just now that you have.
Yeah. I think that's really right. I had a piece actually in the Bulwark yesterday arguing against this idea. There was a story that came out over the weekend by Jonathan Martin in the New York Times saying that there were a bunch of Democratic operatives pushing Joe Biden to get involved in Texas. And I wrote a piece saying, please do not do that. Texas is 30 million people. It is a planet unto himself. Joe Biden, while he's been out fundraising Donald Trump the last 2 months, he's way behind in the cash on hand. I mean, not quite half of what Trump, he's got a little more than half of what Trump has. I mean, it's just, he's playing with the small stack. And so to spread it around the board in places like Texas, because the Democrats think they can press their advantage to go for sort of a political realignment type election, I think is too far. I mean, certainly invest in North Carolina, invest in Arizona, please break his back in Florida. I mean, if you're gonna invest in a massive state, go into Florida where the Fox News polling, which is one of the best polls out there, has got him down by 9 points and where he's just dying with seniors. Like that's a play. But you know, I do think that there's a risk where Democrats, they don't have the same resources because they went through a tough primary and he hasn't had the same amount of time. I will tell you one thing, I would accept Texas as a play if somebody named Mike Bloomberg were to jump in and find, you know, $300 million in the couch cushions. That's a different story. But when he's at a fundraising disadvantage with not that much time left on the clock, he's gotta play to win. And that means not, you know, making sure that Pennsylvania and Wisconsin and Michigan are sewn up, go into Florida, you know, look at Arizona and North Carolina. And the other thing is, look, if you really want to stretch play, stretch into Georgia, where there's two Senate races at least. I've not understood this Texas thing, but I really think, look, just we can't do the same thing. We shouldn't trust the polling. We should look at it. It should be a guide. It should be something we factor in, but it's not, can't take it as gospel by any stretch of the imagination. And so I always just tell people, like, run like you're 10 points behind every day. And so if you were 10 points behind, you'd be putting your money into the main states that you can win to make sure you get to 270. And I do think it's a little bit of a difference sometimes between the Republicans. I got a lot of grief from the Democrats when I said, don't go into Texas, because there was like, who wants to listen to this Republican tell us about why we shouldn't press our advantage in Texas? And I was like, you know, because for me, Trump is an existential threat to democracy. And so I will take no risks. There's like no gambling, no room for gambling. You have to do the thing that's going to make sure you get to 270.
Yeah. I mean, he could take, if Biden takes Michigan, which the Trump campaign has written off, all he has to do is pick up Florida. If he just focused on Florida, that gets him over 270. So I'm of the same ilk as you. You mentioned Georgia, where there are some competitive Senate races. How concerned, or how do you balance the need, I would call it, to destroy Trump and really knock him down, versus the need to hold on to a Senate majority, Republican majority? Is it worth losing the Senate majority? And will it result, if Donald Trump goes down, does the Senate go down with him, and is it worth it?
Yeah, so this is a good question and a tough one that I've thought a lot about. So I like had this incredibly soft spot for like Susan Collins. Susan Collins led the fight to repeal Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And so I know that she's like the one that's in the sights, but it's been hard for me to watch all the moderate Republicans like Carlos Curbelo and Jeff Flake all get run out by Donald Trump. And so we made a decision not to do Senate races in what we're doing. We are very focused on Donald Trump. That being said, there's absolutely value in the Republican Party learning a hard lesson about what they've done with Donald Trump. And so I think the key is for Joe Biden to run up historic margins. And I think that that there are, I may be fond of Susan Collins, but I'm not particularly fond of Martha McSally. And so, you know, if Joe Biden wins by enough and those Senate seats go, I don't think that it's bad at all for the Republican Party to learn the lesson that you nominate a guy like Donald Trump, he decimates the party. That's what you get for it. And so I get a little bit of two minds and ultimately just decided that the best thing for us to do strategically, because we wanted people to participate in our program who weren't necessarily going to vote for Democrats. I mean, we wanted to attract people who were like, look, I'm deeply pro-life. I'll never vote for a Democrat ever. but I'm not going to vote for Donald Trump. I voted for him last time, but I won't do it again. We wanted our tent to be big enough to accommodate those people. And so you can't put together that kind of coalition if you're also doing the Senate's. Because frankly, we want people who are going to maybe vote for Tom Tillis, but aren't going to vote for Donald Trump. Like, mm-hmm. you know, we want those people too. So that's just, there's a strategic answer to that. Then there's also sort of an emotional answer. And they're different.
Sometimes those go hand in hand though. You know, we talk about the future of the Republican Party. You know, assuming Donald Trump loses in November, I have complete faith in our nation coming back stronger and better. I don't know if we can say the same about the Republican Party. We knew what to do in 2012. I mean, we laid it all out. There was an autopsy. It said that we needed to build coalitions, not narrow our focus. The party picked the wrong person for a whole host of reasons. And Donald Trump never cared about the Republican Party. So what happens the day after Election Day, assuming Donald Trump loses? Does our party have the future we once thought it had?
I wish I had better news for you on this front. I think there's some it depends answers. And some of it is like the margin of Donald Trump's loss will matter, because I think that, you know, politics being what it is, people want to have power, and Republicans will want to be in charge again at some point. They will recognize that they can't build a winning coalition just on white working class men and be a regional party. And so I think there's opportunity there to have a fight for the soul of the party. I will say, though, the problem with Donald Trump is he's just not going anywhere. Unless he's in jail, which I think is not off the table entirely. But if he's not in jail, what is he doing? Donald Trump has never cared that much about beating Democrats. He cares about owning the Republican Party. He wants to be the kingmaker in the party. He will, you know, Jeff Sessions, he runs out Jeff Sessions yesterday, and I don't have a ton of love for Jeff Sessions, but he got, Donald Trump is running him out because he did the honorable thing and recused himself in the situation of the special counsel's investigation. And so Donald Trump wants that role, right?
He didn't even pick the better candidate against Doug Jones in that particular case. What would have been good for the party was Sessions, because he would have been more likely to beat Doug Jones.
That's right. And because Donald Trump doesn't care about the party or about the party winning, he cares about his own power and influence. And so, you know, the idea that like George W. Bush goes off to live in Texas and really doesn't stick his head out too much, like that's not what Donald Trump's going to do, right? He's never going to stop talking. He's never going to stop tweeting. He'll probably have his own television network. He'll probably have shows for Ivanka and Jared, and will groom somebody, maybe Tucker Carlson, for the future. And I think if that's the future of the Republican Party and Donald Trump maintains that role, then the party is pretty doomed, and I'm not as optimistic. And I think the reason for the landslide victory needs to be that then the party says to him, this guy doesn't get to have a role, and tries to shut him down. I just think the world being what it is, that's a tough thing to do. I mean, I what do you think Nikki Haley's doing right now? Is she distancing herself from Trump, or is she?
I'm dying to figure out if she'll be at the convention or not. That's the million-dollar question for me. But I think we've covered so much, Sarah, and thank you. There's a lot of questions coming up, so I think I'm going to throw it back to Patricia, who's going to do some of the manage the Q&A. Is that right, Patricia?
Yes, she's just unmuting herself.
Right, okay.
I think I'd have this down by now. Yeah, that was amazing. That was really fascinating. No matter what party you're part of, or not much part of. I wonder if Rick Solomon wants to ask his question.
Rick, you're muted. Just hold on. Just unmute yourself.
There he goes.
Okay. You said earlier, Sarah, it's very interesting about the fact that Trump needs to be destroyed in a landslide in order to be dislodged. Implicit in that is the fact that no, he may not leave office peaceably, and that you need to pry him out with a crowbar. What's your view on that? Because there are a lot of people, including constitutional lawyers, who believe that he will not leave easily.
Yeah, well, it's also a great question. It's something I think about a lot. So here's, it's one of the reasons that I think a worst case scenario. So let's say a worst case scenario is Donald Trump winning in my book. But the next worst case scenario is him losing very narrowly. So one of the key things about this election is that it's going to look different from other elections because we're going to be continue to be in the pandemic very likely. And there's going to be way more vote by mail and absentee ballots that come in. And so the election night's not going to look like a traditional election night, likely, because there's, I mean, if you look at some of the primaries that have happened, you know, the McGrath one in Kentucky, for example, you don't find out the results for a week. And so my biggest concern is that it's a very narrow victory for Joe Biden. And yet there's all these ballots to be counted. And Donald Trump is out there. He's already laid the groundwork for this to start talking about the fact that the election was rigged, that this whole thing, you know, people were ballot harvesting and all this stuff and sowing distrust in the outcome. And I think at that point, right, if let's say there's one instance of an irregularity or something on election night, and Donald Trump is able to use the levers of the federal government to do, I don't know what, but like tell people to cease counting ballots or who knows. And so I think it's, I have less of a fear about the idea of him losing decisively and him not going. Like, I actually think that's not something to worry about. I am worried about it being not as clear cut in who won and it being a little bit of a confusing election because it looks different and for people to like be in the streets over it.
I think that was, I'm sorry. I think Alan Petrikoff, were you trying to ask a question? Anyway, we do have a question from Stan Cohen. Do you want to ask your question, Stan?
Sure. Hi. So my belief is, and I just want to state for the record that might surprise those who know me, I am a lifelong Republican, but I'm like a Javits Republican from when I was growing up. So I'm as liberal as they get. But my question or my scenario is the only way Trump can win is either by a Putin maneuver or or just a miracle happening in the pandemic. What I'm concerned about is Biden comes in and can't do anything in the government because the Senate is still Republican. And so nothing gets accomplished and it becomes a Democratic failure. Do you see that? And do you feel that to move the country forward in a way that restores us, that the Democrats are better in holding all three of the two branches of Congress and the presidency?
I'm not sure, because I think it depends on which Republican senators are still in there. I mean, I think if you've got Collins and Murkowski, and it also depends on what he tries to do. I mean, you know, I think if it's trying to pass the Green New Deal, then obviously that will be frustrated by having, you know, a very narrow Senate majority. But I do think it would be a very narrow Senate majority if they did hold the Senate. And so then you've got, again, and then it depends on who's there. But if you've got Susan Collins and Lisa Murkowski, Mitt Romney, some of these other folks that I think are looking to find some corrective action. I mean, I especially think, so something I think is gonna happen pretty early on, I hope is gonna happen, is that there's gonna be a bunch of sort of, like there was with not Goldwater, after Nixon, you know, where they do a bunch of like rule of law reforms. Like, hey, you can't put your kids in the White House. You can't just install them in the White House and have one of their spouses running the executive branch without proper security clearance. Like, anti-corruption legislation. I think you'd get a lot of Republicans who would support that. And I think you'd get a lot of Republican support for a variety of things if there was, you know, modest movement on healthcare. But I am, as a conservative, I think one of the things I like is for people to have to negotiate and for there to be more incremental change. And so this goes back to Susan's question, which is why it's tough. I want Donald Trump to be thoroughly repudiated, and that probably means him losing the Senate as well so that they learn that lesson. At the same time, I think that the problem with if there is totally unchecked Democratic power and they're running really hard left, then you're looking at a very short period of time where people don't start looking back to the Republican Party as the option to put the brakes on that Democratic Party. And I would like the Republican Party to have a little more time in the wilderness to sort themselves out before, you know, and before they've anointed Tucker Carlson to be the brakes on, you know, the crazy Democratic agenda. And so I think the best case scenario is if it's like incredibly narrow and there's compromise being forced.
But I just wanted to jump in because I think it's a great question and I feel just like Sarah does, but just one other thought, especially since we've seen this in New York, for example, having a Republican controlled, narrowly controlled Senate is a perfect foil for Biden because it allows him to not go, he's not extreme, he is more moderate. So it allows him to say, I couldn't go that far. I could give you this, but I couldn't give you everything. And that's a place he's actually more comfortable in. So there is that to consider. I just want to throw that out there.
It's a great point.
Let me ask you sort of in the same vein, what do you think would be the consequence or what's the possibility of the of Trump finding a way to fight Biden? He doesn't seem to find a frame as of yet to really hurt Biden, but he's searching for one. I hate to almost ask you this question. Is there one that you think he would be most vulnerable to? Is it about being too liberal?
Yeah, I think that, look, I don't think Biden's been particularly vulnerable to most of these things. He just ran in a really bloody primary as the most moderate in a big batch of Democrats. So it's hard to paint him as a, you know, and then blew the socialist out of the water. So it's hard to paint him as a liberal extremist. I do think the biggest issue for Biden is his vice presidential pick. I mean, I don't think that Trump can lay a glove on him. They can try China, but Trump, I mean, everything that Trump does ends up looking like projection, right? When it comes to, you know, if it's China, well, Trump has been, you know, weak on China. Are we going to get into a debate over mental acuity? Because I don't know if you saw that Rose Garden speech yesterday, but Donald Trump should not be in a fight with anybody over their mental acuity. You know, when they go after this like senility argument, Biden's too old. Well, that actually hurts him with a lot of the older voters. And so Trump has been like, they wanted to run on an economy. They don't have it. So now they're trying to run on culture wars. The problem is they're talking about monuments while most Americans are thinking, how am I going to send my kids to school safely? And why isn't there a plan? And they're not as interested. You know, it's not as fun to own the libs when you can't own a car or own your house because we're in double digit unemployment. And so I think that there's not that much, yeah, he just hasn't been able to get a toehold against Biden. But if like Donald Trump's dream right now, like if I put myself in their shoes and I think, what do they want to happen? They want Elizabeth Warren. Like they want somebody that they can really say, yep, that's the Democratic Party we've told you to be really scared of. I'm not entirely confident it'll work just because of the pandemic scenario and that changing everything. But that is their best case scenario and hope. And I think that would be, the mistake would be going too far left in a VP pick with a candidate who is old enough that people think this person could definitely end up being president.
Thank you. Nancy Collins, you're next.
Hi, I was wondering if Biden really wants to play to win, who would you choose as his vice president?
You made me go on the record with a pick, huh? This is hard because my own personal biases are really like wrapped up in this. I would have told him to probably go with Amy Klobuchar and just like grab somebody. Like, I think that I have more of a sense of what the profile should be of the person that he should pick, which is, you know, Joe Biden has been a vice president, so he knows what it takes to be a good vice president, which is loyalty, like somebody you can get along with, have a good relationship with, who's gonna, you know, carry out your agenda by not, you know, running for president the whole time that they're there. And I think that if you pick somebody that's far from him ideologically, that's a recipe for disaster. So look, I mean, I think he'd be the most comfortable with somebody like Amy Klobuchar, maybe Kamala Harris, although I think you do with Kamala would probably be my second choice, but I do think you end up with somebody like her, with someone who's basically running for president from the moment that she becomes the vice president. You know, Susan Rice has been tossed out, which I think is not a bad choice, but that means everybody gets to relitigate Benghazi. So that's a pitfall there. You know, my choices are all people like Gina Raimondo. I think Gretchen Whitmer is a pretty interesting one just because she's handled the pandemic well in the eyes of her constituents. And so she could be good. There's not a silver, you know, honestly, you know who he should choose for vice president is Cory Booker. I want there to be a female in the White House as much as anybody, but like Cory Booker's right for this moment. And I think he would have made a stellar VP pick, but Biden has locked himself in. And so he's locked himself into, and you know, when Amy Klobuchar kind of stepped back and said, I really think it needs to be a person, a woman of color. Not only did she take herself out, she basically took Elizabeth Warren out with her, which just shows you how vicious Amy Klobuchar can be. If you're really narrow in terms of, you know, a woman of color who has experience at a pretty high level, you know, then you're down to very few people. And I, like everybody else, get sort of taken by the news cycle, like, oh, look at Keisha Lance Bottoms, isn't she interesting? But she's a mayor. She's a mayor that you know we just saw give one awesome speech on CNN during the protests. I don't know that necessarily says, ah, we should definitely make her vice president. So it's actually a pretty tough decision, I think, for him, one of the bigger ones facing him.
That's a
Someone's sound, I think, went out.
Yeah, I thought maybe we were frozen. Patricia, were you saying something?
Maybe Patricia's frozen. Oh. Bernard Schwartz is trying to ask a question. Can someone pick Bernard Schwartz?
Yes, no problem. Bernard, you are more than you can speak. Just once you are unmuted, sir. Bernard, you're muted.
Sir. Bernard, you're muted. You're muted.
Can you unmute him, or do you need me to? Okay.
Hello?
We can hear you.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm a lifelong Democrat, have always been a Democrat, and always will be a Democrat, I hope, I think. I have to tell you, I am very, very worried about this election for a lot of reasons. There's 3 months left to go. I'm sure that Trump will come in with another package, maybe $1 trillion, that'll get him through the next 3 months to help the people who are unemployed, and he will have a good portion of their vote, okay? I'm concerned about the fact that we Democrats do not have a spokesperson. The only thing I get from Mr. Biden, whom I love dearly, is a package saying this is what he said yesterday. I like to see him on TV showing how he would be a vivid, vital leader of this country going forward. I think that he will have good news, Trump will have good news or fair news about the epidemic. They'll keep on trying, they'll keep on coming out with good news. So all in all, this is not going to be a runaway for the Democrats. And we are not geared up for a real good, heavy fight. We need a fighter in there. I think Biden can be so, but he has to be advised that he has to be out there in front. He's the person that has to be there with the new ideas, with the issues that we have to face as a country. Don't kid yourself. This is not going to be a blowaway because some Republicans are going to join us. It's going to be tough, and we're not geared for it.
Oh, that's the right attitude to have. I mean, I think that the last thing anybody should do is get overconfident. And I think after what happened in 2016, we should all live with that PTSD, and we should channel exactly what you just said. And I'll say the thing about Biden, because I agree with you, I've been sort of two minds about how he's been handling himself. Because on one hand, this election really is going to be a referendum on Donald Trump in many ways. And so Joe Biden kind of very sort of strategically sticking his head out every now and then to give a good speech and remind people that he is the nominee seems to be working in the sense that Donald Trump is just self-immolating. That being said, when I do the focus groups and I talk to people who don't like Donald Trump, but they're really on the fence, They're really on the fence about potentially voting for Biden. The biggest thing that they always say is they're like, yeah, I don't know that much about him. Like, what does he stand for? And I think that one of the things that's been surprising to me is that for somebody who's been in politics for 40 years and who's the most recent vice president, he actually is pretty undefined with voters. And I think at some point he really is going to have to do more to present a positive and affirmative vision that give people a reason to vote for him, not just a reason for people to vote against Trump. And I think just going back to the earlier question that was sort of like, well, what could Joe Biden do to really mess things up? And I do think one of the things that he could do is if he comes out and in some way starts demonstrating that he really isn't up to it for some reason, you know, if he got into, and I don't just mean one bad debate, but if, you know, look, I think you can look at Joe Biden and think he's lost his fastball a little bit. But I think people are willing to accept that because Donald Trump, you know, isn't even playing the same sport. But I do think he's going to have to perform at some point, and people are going to have a reason to really vote for him, not just against Trump.
We've got time for one quick question. Kathy Wallach, are you ready, or we're going to go to Bob Wyman?
Oh, I'm ready. Thank you. Okay, I had two, but I'll ask the one that John had also asked. Do you think that there's any chance that Trump will see as we get closer to the election that he's going to lose and that he'll resign?
You know, I don't think so. I think that Donald Trump, will squeeze every last ounce of juice out of everybody's attention being on him as possible, number one. Because that's just like, that's just his psychological profile. Two, he pulled the rabbit out of the hat last time, and I think he believes in his own potential magic. So I think that he will stay and do that. I also think, you know, for Donald Trump, he is better off as president for his own, I think legal problems that he is facing. Like, there are a lot of pending cases against him. And the Supreme Court just came forward with a couple other things that they're going to be able to look into further. And so he is much better when he can exert executive privilege. And so I think you are going to have to pry the presidency out of his hands with a landslide victory. I mean, maybe some deal gets made about Pence pardoning him, but I just think that's the stuff of, I actually think of all the like conspiracy theories of what crazy thing could happen, I think the biggest one is Trump picking Nikki Haley, is swapping out VPs like at the convention. That's the one that I'm most like bought into being a real potentiality. And it's because Donald Trump's a showman and, you know, he doesn't like the script right now. The narrative's bad for him and he needs to shake it up. And, you know, Joe Biden's going to have a woman as his VP. And like, Donald Trump just needs to change the conversation. And I think that it's possible that I've watched Nikki Haley very closely. She was high on my list for the person that I thought should primary Donald Trump. And she has moved closer and closer toward Donald Trump in a way that seems very strategic. And I can't quite figure it out because I know that's not, I just don't believe that's who she is deep down. So anyway, maybe not Haley, because I don't know that she'd do it, because I think she's got a great shot at being the nominee in 2024, but that's my, if I was going to buy into like, here's the crazy, crazy thing that could happen, that would, what I would put my money on.
That's fascinating. Well, just before we, shoot it back to Susan for any last thoughts, what about, Tammy Duckworth?
Oh yeah. Thanks. I should have talked about her. You know, I don't know Tammy Duckworth particularly well, like a lot of the people that keep getting floated. You know, I thought that she handled the Tucker Carlson knock on her extremely well, and kind of eviscerated him with her, you know, you should walk a mile on my legs before you criticize my patriotism. I thought that was good. But I also thought her answer, the first thing that got her in trouble in the beginning, was sort of not taking a complete and clear stand around, you know, people taking down the Washington Monument. I think she's probably an impressive person. And I do think that there is a tendency on the Democrats' part to pick sort of federal candidates. Like, I do think they like picking senators more so than mayors and governors, which is a slightly more Republican thing to do. But I don't know, besides the fact that she is sort of a war hero. What do people know about her? So she could be. She's an interesting choice, and my colleague Bill Kristol is kind of high on her as a potential pick. But I don't know.
Last thought, Susan, but we're over time, but this one I really hate to end. It's so fascinating.
No, I just think just overall, and I really appreciate Sarah's answers because they're actually questions that I've had a tough time struggling with myself, is that we have to keep focused on what the goal is. It's 270 for Joe Biden. It's to take down Trump and do it hopefully as decisively as we can, but let's not forget we may be counting ballots for 2 or 3 weeks after Election Day, if it's that close. But let's beat Donald Trump. That's priority number one.
Thank you. Thank you, Sarah. That was fascinating. I could sit here all day listening to you. You're brilliant, and I wish you good luck with your work. Everybody, Susan, you were just wonderful. I hope we have you back soon again. You're always fantastic. So thank you so much. I hope this is an opportunity for us to keep a sense of community while we are all in our basements and working for engaging in our democracy and making it better. So please come next week. We've got Tom Rogers and his daughter, Jessica Rogers-Ecker, who's an attorney, are going to talk about social media, the youth vote, and the 2020 election. Congressman Eric Swalwell with Dennis Meehl on the House Committee investigation and the other things that he's been working on. Retired Colonel Chris Kalenda with former Homeland Security Secretary Jay Johnson on the never-ending, it seems, war in Afghanistan. Thank you, Sarah. You are just fabulous. Thank you, Susan. We'll hope we see you both again. Thank you.
Thank you.